trust I'm holding on. The substance of your hope and love. The substance of your hope and love. In your hand I'll face the storms. In your will I'm pressing on.
We are in Matthew chapter 9, verses 1 to 17, a message entitled, Our Savior Forgives Sins. And just to try to introduce this real briefly, again, we're in this portion, we're the other side of the Sermon on the Mount. Matthew, again, is laying out his information, not chronologically, but topically, grouping it together in three sets of triplets in terms of miraculous things that Jesus has done. And he's doing this to show the compassion of Jesus and the credentials of Jesus, that he is the Messiah, he is the fulfillment of prophecy and so forth. And what we have here is a couple of things begin to turn a corner. Most notably, we have an official delegation of Pharisees that have come from Jerusalem because they've heard about an itinerant rabbi in Galilee making messianic claims and healing and so forth. And they're there to check him out, which was their job and they were supposed to do. Jesus is going to say something to them, very confrontational, but leads us into really what Matthew is hoping we'll see is the reason that Jesus came, certainly as the Messiah. He had to prove his credentials, but then he had to make the point that he came to forgive sins. And that's what really sets a course then in this statement is an ongoing confrontation with the Pharisees. Let's take a look at the first eight verses. Jesus validates his authority to forgive sins. Again, we're in Matthew's Gospel, chapter 9. Jesus stepped into a boat, crossed over, came to his own town. Some men brought him a paralytic lying on a mat. When Jesus saw their faith, he said to the paralytic, "Take heart, my son, your sins are forgiven." At this, some of the teachers of the law said to themselves, "This fellow is blaspheming." Verse 4, knowing their thoughts, Jesus said, "Why do you entertain evil thoughts in your hearts? Which is easier to say, your sins are forgiven, or to say, get up and walk? But so that you may know that the Son of Man has authority on earth to forgive sins." Then he said to the paralytic, "Get up, take your mat, and go home." And the man got up and went home. When the crowd saw this, they were filled with awe, and they praised God who had given such authority to men. First thing we note is the friends that bring a friend to Jesus. And these guys are classic. And you're probably more familiar with the story from Luke's Gospel or Mark's. Let me kind of read it from Mark's if you want to go over a couple of pages. Mark 2:2 says, "Some men came bringing him a paralytic carried by four of them." That's why we know there were four. "Since they could not get him to Jesus because of the crowd, they made an opening in the roof above Jesus. After digging through it, lowered the mat the paralyzed man was lying on. When Jesus saw their faith, he said to the paralytic, 'Son, your sins are forgiven.'" So this is kind of the classic story. They get there, and the crowd is huge. They can't get him to Jesus, so they actually go up onto the roof, and the roofs were tiled, and they could just remove the tiles and then lower him down, the four of them on ropes. I'm sure that was quite a scene, lowering him down in front of Jesus. And then this conversation between the two. Just a couple of things, obviously. These guys are great examples of what it takes to lead somebody to Christ, literally. It took some real determination. I mean, they could have easily got there and went, big crowd, we'll pick a better day. This isn't going to work out. Hey, we give it our best shot. I'm not getting any younger. This thing is killing my back. On the roof, no way. The owner of the house will shoot us or something. But they really didn't allow anything to deter them. They firmly believed, evidently, that Jesus Christ was this man's only hope. And they also believed that if they could get him to Jesus, Jesus would heal him. So again, Jesus notes their faith, not the faith of the man on the mat. He's just, we don't really hear a lot about him at all. It also took some planning. They were able to lower him and actually drop him right in front of Jesus. So We don't know if they looked in a window and counted the roof tiles and over this way and then went up on the roof, but it took some planning. It took some determination. It took some strategy, and certainly we should all have that kind of determination in leading others to Christ. I like what Rudyard Kipling once said about the Salvation Army. He wasn't a big fan. He says, "I hate their tambourines. I hate their brass bands. I don't know why they use these kind of things to try to propagate the gospel." And again, you know, Salvation Army's been around for a while, but they were cutting edge evangelism in their day. They were, those brass bands were the rock bands of their day. That's what people were into. That's what General Booth used to reach them with the gospel. He said himself, "If I could win one soul to the Lord by standing on my head and playing the tambourine with my feet, I would learn to do it. Whatever it takes to get the gospel to someone." And certainly that's indicative of these four guys. It's really what Jesus would speak about later in Matthew 11:12. He says there, "From the days of John the Baptist until now, the kingdom of heaven has been forcibly advancing, and forceful men lay hold of it." What these guys were doing were great determination. They wouldn't let anything stop them from bringing their friend to Jesus. Secondly, and more importantly, obviously, is the statement of Jesus that forgiveness is given to the friend. He says, "Take heart, son, your sins are forgiven." Now, keep in mind, that's not what the guy came for. He came to be healed physically. Really no intention of being healed spiritually and so forth. Again, Matthew is kind of putting this story in here on purpose that we'd realize the real intent of Jesus and why he came is so that our sins would be forgiven. It's here also because we see the first of this confrontation between him and the Pharisees. But nonetheless, Jesus is ministering to the greater need. I had remember Pastor Chuck's story, which I've got a few, but some folks in the one of the early days in one of the smaller churches he was pastoring brought in a young guy that was in the church and had been in a wheelchair and had been for a number of years. But he had Chuck could see, he wanted prayer, and Chuck could see he had very bad cold and was wheezing and so on and so forth. And so when they asked for prayer, Chuck said, "Oh, sure, I'd be happy to," and Chuck, lays his hands on him and prays, "This terrible winters we're having, and Lord, pray you'd relief this young guy," names him by name and everything. "He's terrible things he's going through here with this cold and so forth." And then the guy jumps up out of the wheelchair. God had healed him. Well, that's not exactly what Chuck was praying for, but God had other intentions that day. Again, obviously it wasn't Chuck's faith. It was the other guy's. But this guy came for one reason, but God had something else in mind that was radically different. Ministering to the greater need. It's one thing to meet the physical needs when we do the outreach on the North Shore in a few weeks. There'll be a lot of food given away. There'll be a lot of clothing given away. There'll be hygiene kits given away to all of the folks on the beach and stuff. It'll be a great time for kids and everything. The whole carnival is free. But the point of all of that is to see their sins forgiven, to lead them to Christ. That's the greater gift. Thirdly, the ability to forgive his sin is proven. Again, the Pharisees right away basically say that Jesus, in saying that your sins are forgiven, is blasphemy. Jesus then says, "Why do you entertain evil thoughts in your heart?" So obviously Jesus knows what's going on in our thought life. So we might as well be very honest with him when we pray to him and so forth. Hebrews 4:13 says, "Nothing in all creation is hidden from God's sight. Everything is uncovered and laid bare before the eyes of him to whom we must give an account." Jesus knows what's in their hearts, and yet he says, "Take heart, son, your sins are forgiven." Now, the Pharisees were right to be alarmed. They were right in saying that Jesus was blaspheming if he was only a man, because only God could forgive sins. They see Jesus. He's making messianic claims. Yes, he's healing people. He has the power to heal and so forth. But now this is a whole different issue in terms of seeing that your sins are forgiven. So we appreciate the fact that the Pharisees made this point, pointing out that Jesus is either a liar or he is the Lord. And he is claiming deity at this point by being able to offer forgiveness of sins. In Israel at that time, there was kind of the prevailing rabbinical thought that if you were like this man, it was because of sin in your life. If you had some radical medical problem, it was because of sin, and this was somehow a judgment of God against you. And we see that reflected even in the thinking of the disciples of Jesus in John 9. There his disciples asked him, "Rabbi, who sinned, this man or his parents, that he was born blind?" "Neither this man nor his parents sinned," said Jesus. "But this happened so that the work of God might be displayed in his life." Neither one. But again, that doesn't mean that this man paralyzed wasn't a sinner, didn't need to be forgiven. Jesus considers it the greater thing to do for him. He forgives him of his sins. The Pharisees are upset by this. They've come to examine and check him out and see if his claims were true. Not only now is he claiming to be the Messiah, he's claiming deity. So Jesus says to them in response, which is easier to say, your sins are forgiven, or to say, get up and walk? But so that you may know that the Son of Man has authority on earth to forgive sins. Jesus says, you're right, I'm claiming deity. Would you like me to prove it? Which would be easier for me to say? Rise up and walk, or your sins be forgiven? Well, in a sense, it would be easier to say your sins are forgiven because it's not really visible, right? Hey, your sins are forgiven. How can I tell? But if I say, rise up and walk, then the paralyzed man, obviously known in that community and so forth, if he gets up and walk, well, then that's quite a statement. Jesus heals him in order to try to prove to them that his words were true. And of course, the man rises up and walks, and they go, praise the Lord. No, they don't. they're still very bent and turned against him and threatened against him. Far too often, like the Pharisees, we're looking for something visible, where our focus has a tendency to be on the physical and not the spiritual and what God is doing in our own lives. At the same time, we need to realize that we have an enemy that really wants us to doubt our own forgiveness, and that's really the thrust of the passage. God has forgiven us if we've come to faith in Jesus Christ. If we've placed our faith in him and be recipients of his grace because of his finished work on the cross, then our sins are forgiven. All of our sins. All of our sins that we've ever committed to that point in time. All the sins that we might commit at that moment. All of the sins that we might commit in the future. You believe that? That's what the Bible says. How can you know physically? How can you? Well, there is a way to know, and that's, again, the physical test is not some kind of a healing that we have physically, being crippled or something. The physical results is the resurrection of Jesus Christ and his going to the cross. I want to read a cross-reference where Paul deals with this issue in Colossians. I've got it for you. If you're an underliner, you might want to turn to it. There's a very important couple of words that might be helpful to you. The next time that the devil comes around, wants to, based on your behavior on a particular occasion, wants to get you to doubt your salvation or whether your sins really are forgiven, Paul says this in Colossians 2:10. In him, in Jesus, you were also circumcised in the putting off of the sinful nature, not with the circumcision done by the hands of men, but the circumcision done by Christ, having been buried with him in baptism, and raised with him through your faith in the power of God who raised him from the dead. When you were dead in your sins and in the uncircumcision of your sinful nature, God made you alive with Christ. He forgave us all of our sins. How many? All. I looked it up in the Greek and it means all. Verse 14, having canceled the written code and its regulations that was against us and that stood opposed to us, he took it away, nailing it to the cross, and having disarmed the powers and authorities, he made a public spectacle of them, triumphing over them by the cross. So again, our sins have all been forgiven. Jesus Christ, the Messiah, came, again, with his compassion, showing his credentials. All of that was set the stage that we would understand that he can forgive us of all of our sins. A couple of remarks about Paul's passage here. One, the obvious, because of the cross, God forgave us all of our sins. Paul uses the term here, forgive, which means grace. Literally, God has graced us in Christ Jesus. That means there's nothing conditional upon my forgiveness. I place my faith. It's not based on my performance or how I do on a particular day. It's all based on what Christ has done for me. There's no conditions. Again, Paul says, where sin increased, grace increased all the more. Now, again, Paul goes on and says, so shall I go on sinning that his grace might be even greater? And he says, by no means. But again, nobody is beyond the reach of Christ, and we're about ready to see a demonstration of that in the next couple of verses. But secondly, because of the cross, God has canceled the law that was against us. We've got a beautiful couple of illustrations that are framed in the entryway. If you look at the one going out today on the right, you're going to see a cross, and it's going to have a scroll and a lot of writing in Hebrew on it, and it's nailed to the cross. And that's that artist's rendition of this passage of Scripture. God took the law that was against us, that condemned us, and he nailed it to the cross, making a public spectacle of it, showing that all of our sins have been forgiven. If you're Jewish and you follow the 1613 commandments of the Old Testament that you're unable to keep, God nailed it to the cross, no longer condemning you. If you're not Jewish and you're Gentile, then God took what was in creation that spoke of God's existence and his power and his glory and majesty that every person around the world can see, Paul says in Romans 1, and he took the internal witness of your conscience, which condemns you when you do sin, and he took that law and he nailed it to the cross. I don't think it was written in Hebrew, but he nailed it to the cross as an open public display to say all of our sins have been forgiven. But again, we have a tendency because of our flesh, our sin nature, to want to somehow, I understand that, but I still want to earn it. Instead of just enjoying the blessings of God. Again, the Christian experience is one of a response. God saves me. He shows me his love and his mercy and his grace. And whatever I do is just in response to that. I'm not the initiator. God is. So again, Matthew's introducing, trying to help us understand this idea, but it is what we might call a paradox to those that are hearing it for the first time. Verse 26, back to our passage in the Gospel of Matthew. Verse 26, of the crowd that's watching all of this, hearing the little thoughts, hearing the words between Jesus and the Pharisee, watching this man be healed and so forth, it says that everyone was amazed. That term amazed is the Greek word paradoxia, again, where we get our word paradox or strange things. These were strange things. Jesus the Messiah, they were beginning to believe that, to accept that. He's healing everybody by the thousands, eventually by the tens of thousands, all of them every time. When confronted, as we saw last week, with a group of demons known as Legion, he just says, go, and that's enough, and they're all gone. Tremendous power and authority. He quiets the storms on the Sea of Galilee and so forth. But this is a whole different thing. Things are really escalating. He's claiming that he can forgive sins. Wow. If he can forgive sins, then he's claiming not just to be the Messiah, not just the Son of Man, not just the Son of God. He's claiming to be God come in the flesh. And they're going, wow, these are strange things. This seems to be a paradox to us. We don't really understand, but something's going on here. So there's a couple of dynamics involved here. But Jesus validated his authority to forgive sins. Next, he's going to demonstrate his compassion for sinners. And this is quite the party that we see in verse 9. As Jesus went on from there, he saw a man named Matthew sitting at the tax collector's booth. Follow me, he told him, and Matthew got up and followed him. While Jesus was having dinner at Matthew's house, many tax collectors and sinners came and ate with him and his disciples. When the Pharisees saw this, they asked his disciples, why does your teacher eat with tax collectors and sinners? On hearing this, Jesus said, it is not the healthy who need a doctor, but the sick. But go and learn what this means. I desire mercy, not sacrifice, for I have not come to call the righteous, but sinners. Wow, Jesus calls Matthew as one of his disciples. And of course, from the other Gospels, we know that Matthew is Matthew Levi. Matthew Levi, the tax collector. That's a pretty loaded statement right there. It means that he's got those Levi genes, right? I mean, Matthew is supposed to be serving in the temple. What is he doing instead? He's a tax collector. Again, the tax collector, a vassal of the government of Rome, somebody that's Jewish, that's sold out to the enemy in order to become wealthy. Again, they weren't rich, they were wealthy. The Romans said, you collect this much money, but they could collect as much as they wanted. They could make as much profit as they wanted. And he's there in the city of Capernaum, as our text said, where Jesus made his home during this time. Also the home of Peter, James, and John. Guess who Peter, James, and John have been paying their taxes to all of these years? Guess who they hate? This is not the same thing as us paying taxes. This is a whole different thing. This is an enemy that's invaded your land, that has taken every dime you can possibly make from you. And they cannot stand Matthew. Matthew Levi was one of the most hated men in Israel at that time. And that's not a hyperbole. If you were a tax collector, you could not serve as a witness in court. You were excommunicated from the synagogue. You could never step in the temple nor a synagogue, which there was one there in Capernaum. You were considered the same as a robber or a murderer if you were a tax collector. So this is one of the most hated men around, and this is somebody that Jesus comes. And then again, this follow me is not a casual thing. It's not just a remark he makes. Hey, you doing anything this afternoon? Matthew would have been there in the community. He would have heard lots of Jesus's teaching. He would have seen him do many miracles. He would have been observing the whole thing, and Jesus would have been observing him as he hung back in the crowds and watched what was going on. And now he extends to him an official rabbinical invitation to come be his disciple, which meant he would have to leave everything. He would have to live in complete subjection to the authority of Jesus, his rabbi, during this time period. It was considered a tremendous honor to receive an official invitation. You couldn't say, can I sign up? The invitation had to be given to you. It was already shocking that he had called Peter, James, and John to him because they had not progressed through the Shivas. They had not gone through all of the religious schools. They probably went to the ones like elementary school kind of to us, and that was enough. And they probably had a good background and education and in the Torah and everything. And then it was time to go work for their fathers in the fishing business. They were not somebody that typically would get an official invitation to become a disciple of a rabbi. That was shocking enough, but now Matthew, the tax collector, gets an official call. The other thing that to consider about this that I found interesting kind of thinking about it is that Peter, James, and John, and Andrew, if they decided at some point in time that this was really not cut out for them, they could always go back to the fishing business, which they did, right? We know they did from time to time when they weren't supposed to. Matthew couldn't do that. If he walks away from this position given to him by the Roman government, he there's no going back. He would never get it again. So when he leaves and Jesus says, follow me, I mean, it's everything. I mean, he can never go back to his former way of life. And yet we find him immediately following Jesus. Then the second thing, he calls him, and then he came, he says, not to the righteous, but to sinners. And there's a tremendous banquet that's thrown at his home, and again, it would have been a very large home. Jesus was the guest of honor, and there's a couple of phrases here that are important to note in verse 10. While Jesus was having dinner at Matthew's house, many tax collectors and sinners came and ate with him. Anytime the word sinner in its noun form is used in the New Testament, particularly in the gospel, it's always making reference to sexual immorality. I mean, the tax collectors were sinners, right? They're all sinners. So when it uses this form, it's talking about one of a couple of kind of people that were there. You had all the tax collectors, those that were most hated in the community. You had prostitutes, known adulterers and homosexuals. That's who filled this very large home with this great party. Matthew obviously has invited all of his friends to meet Jesus in, which is quite a thing when you think about it. But you can understand why the Pharisees, this official delegation from Jerusalem, they're already shocked enough. They're shocked enough that Jesus is claiming to have the authority to forgive sins. Then he does what he can do at that point in time to prove to them that he can forgive sins. And then he calls Matthew, the tax collector, to be one of his official disciples. And then he goes into this house with the rest of these people. And then he eats with them, which would have been a huge deal in that culture. In that culture, as it is today in the Middle East and in a lot of other places, and that if you go into someone's home, it's one thing, have a conversation with them. But if you sit down to have a meal with them, that's a whole nother thing. They served what we would call family style, all the food on the table, all the food in bowls, kind of like they do in a lot of places today. Some of the places I've been, you eat with your hands, and so you tear off the bread, you dip it in the gravy or whatever you're eating, and then you eat it, and that guy tears off the same piece of bread, and he's eating out of the same bowl that you're eating out of. And their idea, they didn't understand bacteria, but they did understand this concept that which you're taking in is nourishing you. And you're taking in the same thing and it's nourishing you. We're becoming one as we have this meal together. It says a lot more. We kind of get it. I mean, we're fortunate in Hawaii. If you grow up here, you don't really realize it until you go out of the culture and come back how Asian or Eastern we are here. But it's the same way. If you have somebody come over and they eat with you, that's good. I mean, that's more than just, hey, how's it once in a while. But if you share meals together, you have a much closer relationship. There's just that understanding and everything. We kind of get that, but it's much more dramatic. So here's Jesus claiming the authority to forgive sins. They're already upset about that because he's claiming not just to be the Messiah, but to be God come in the flesh. And now he calls Matthew. He's already got this bunch of fishermen that don't deserve to be rabbinical students in their minds. They didn't go where they went to school. They didn't have the same upbringing they had. There's these country bumpkin guys from up there in Galilee. They speak with a funny accent. I don't know if you know, but they spoke pidgin. Hebrew pidgin, of course, but and everything. And now they get to be, disciples. Now he calls Matthew a tax collector, which means for interesting dynamic with this group. No wonder they were always fighting over who get to sit next to Jesus at the table and so forth, and who really deserved to be there. But now Jesus is in the midst of this large group. Matthew's gospel tells us it was a great banquet. It was a large crowd, and there's a tremendous confrontation going on. The Pharisees come along. Maybe Jesus is too much in the middle of the crowd to say anything, so they say to his disciples, "Why do you eat and drink with tax collectors and sinners?" Again, Jesus doesn't argue the point that they're sinners. They're definitely all sinners, but that's the point. And he says to them in verse 12, "It is not the healthy who need a doctor, but the sick. But go and learn what this means. I desire mercy, not sacrifice. For I have not come to call the righteous, but to sinners." And if you've got an NIV, there's a word missing, to repentance. It's in the manuscripts. It ought to be there. If you like to write in your Bibles, you should add those words. Jesus comes to call sinners to himself that they might be forgiven so that they would repent. And that's what you find in again, the better manuscripts that the King James, New King James are use. But the main point here is that Jesus is quoting the prophet Hosea. Again, the classic verse from Hosea 6:8 is, "He has shown you, O man, what is good. And what does the Lord require of you? To act justly and to love mercy and to walk humbly with your God." The Pharisees, again, they were a back to the Bible movement originally. They were the good guys originally. not wanting to fall into the Greek influence, the Hellenistic influence that had been brought into Israel by Antiochus Epiphany. They were going to hold to the scriptures and the inerrancy of scriptures and live according to the word of God that he had given to them. Unfortunately, over the years, they had built around the word this other hedge of tradition. It's like, how do we keep the word of God? Well, we don't want to break the word of God. We'll develop a hedge around it. If we keep the traditions around it, we'll never break the law inside. So focused on that, they forgot its purpose. They forgot that the only reason they could know God was because of his grace and his mercy and the faith that they placed in God's word and their obedience and so forth. They'd kind of drifted away. Let me give you a local illustration. If you walk around the campus of Punahou today, you'll see inscribed in many places monuments to the glory of God, the proclamation of the gospel. Why? Because Punahou was established by the early missionaries that, unlike what you hear in many circles, took a vow of poverty, came not knowing what would happen to them to bring the gospel. Again, having read the memoirs of Henry Opukaya, and they come over with the gospel and so forth. They established the school in order to, so that their kids and other kids could read and be able to understand the Bible and share the gospel eventually with others. Now, there's another school locally, very similar foundation, Kamehameha Schools, established by the Queen. For what reason? To make sure the Hawaiian children would grow up literate so they could read their Bibles. Did you know that it's a Christian school? So they could read their Bibles. They could grow up and be mature Christians in the Lord. Same kind of monuments around there. In the deed, in the trust, to make sure that it would happen. In fact, I've had to sign letters of recommendation on behalf of some folks from the church that taught at Kamehameha Schools, because you have to be a member in good standing of a Protestant church in order to be a teacher at Kamehameha Schools. Now, let me ask you this. Would you say that most of the teachers and most of the students at those two schools are Christians today? I would say probably not. Would you say there are some Christians that are teachers and some Christians that are students? Some. I would say some. The Pharisees started out great, not what they were at one time. Where some of them still loved the Lord, showed mercy, some of them did. But most of them had very, 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 very removed themselves from the intent of God's word, which was to know him, have a relationship with him, and show his mercy. Jesus quotes Hosea. You guys are missing the point. It's not what the Lord requires. He's more interested in you loving others than keeping the sacrifice. You don't really understand. This is why I came. I came to save sinners. Jesus was in the middle of them. Now, here's a good question. People ask me, well, I think I'll be going down to the bar and the nightclubs this week. Because, you know, Jesus would, that's the kind of thing he would do. I go and I say, praise God. That's great that you've got a heart to go down, reach those people with the gospel. Let me make sure I give you some tracts and everything. You might want to take some New Testaments with you, because that's why Jesus went, to make sure he could share with people and their sins would be forgiven. Tremendous ministry. God bless you. You know, maybe you should probably take two or three people. We'll get a prayer team outside as you go in to share that. Oh, that's not what you're going for? Oh, you shouldn't be going then. See, that's why Jesus went. It's not where you're going, it's why you're going. And Jesus did go. This is the most radical party in town, and Jesus was in the middle of it, but it was for a reason, that he might show sinners that their sins could be forgiven. Great demonstration of his compassion. Verse 14, then, we go on, and we have what seems to be an interlude. Again, this conversation with some disciples of John the Baptist, but we'll try to tie it all together in a moment. Verse 14, then John's disciples came and asked him, how is it that we and the Pharisees fast, but your disciples do not fast? Jesus answered, how can the guest of a bridegroom mourn while he's with them? The time will come when the bridegroom will be taken away from them, then they will fast. No one sews a patch of unshrunk cloth on an old garment, for the patch will pull away from the garment, making the tear worse. Neither do men pour new wine into old wineskins. If they do, the skins will burst. The wine will run out and the wineskins will be ruined. No, they pour new wine into new wineskins and both are preserved. Again, Jesus validates his ability to forgive sin. He demonstrates his compassion to the sinner. Now he illustrates a unique plan for sinners. Now, he's already dealt with the Pharisees and given a couple of illustrations and here two parables. The first illustration that he gave in terms of the newness of life that he offers us as forgiven sinners is the illustration of a doctor. It is not the healthy that need a doctor. The Pharisees saw the friends of Levi as radical sinners, and so they wanted to have nothing to do with them. Jesus saw them as radical sinners, so he wanted to have everything to do with them. Joe mentioned being at the banquet, and I had dinner next to me was one of the Gideons, a guy named Ed from San Diego, and we had a great time talking over dinner and so forth, and he was saying how they had, him and the other one, Gideons, that had come over for the conference, had in about 4 days had passed out 60,000 little New Testaments throughout Waikiki and different places, just did a whole blitz, and just tremendous, and that's the thing to see is that it's not just a Bible and a hotel, it's a heart for the lost. And Ed really exemplified that. He didn't get saved till he was about 52 years old. He felt like he's had a lot of things, a lot of time to make up for that he kind of missed along the way. And he was here the very first morning. He went out walking in Waikiki. He was getting ready to cross the street. And there next to him was a young guy. And he's got a tattoo going down his neck, big letters, faith. And he thought, that's all I need. Walked right over to him. But I want to say that there would be a lot of guys Ed's age that would look at a guy with lots of tattoos and go, I don't get it. That disgusts me. And just walk the other way. But see, Ed, you know, kind of had the heart of the Lord here. He saw that tattoo and went, that's an open door to share the Lord. He just went right up to the guy. Hey, I noticed your tattoo, man. Faith. Do you have faith in God? Do you believe in God? And he says, well, yeah, I believe in God. Oh, that's great. That's great. Now, but do you know him personally? Do you know Jesus? Have you had your sins forgiven? Have you ever heard the gospel? No, I don't know what that is. Can I share it with you? Okay. He shares the gospel with him and leads the guy to the Lord. The guy prays to receive the Lord right there on the sidewalk in Waikiki. And the guy goes, wow, this is great. I got to show you my other tattoo. He pulls up his arm. John 3:16. He didn't know. He says, what does that verse mean? And he tells him what John 3:16 is. The guy says, oh, that's great. I've got it on my arm. I've got it on my neck. My sins are forgiven. This is great. I want to say that probably any one of us could have walked up to that guy at some point in time and led him to the Lord, that he was just ready. But Ed's a guy that didn't look at him as a radical sinner and walk away. He looked at him as a radical sinner that needed the Lord. That's the heart of Jesus here. And he sees them as they're sick and I got the medicine. I'm the doctor. That's the first illustration. The second one is that of a bridegroom. Sinners need the joy only a Savior can bring. Two illustrations that he uses here for that. And again, one is the bridegroom. They say your disciples go on eating and drinking, and Jesus has said this is only right that they should. They shouldn't be fasting and mourning at this point. That's the question in time. Why don't your disciples fast like us? We're the disciples of John the Baptist. Us and the Pharisees, we fast twice a week. Why don't you guys fast? We notice that you don't do that. And he says, well, here's an illustration. It's like I'm the bridegroom, and they're my groomsmen. And you remember during the Passover Seder, we kind of had the illustration, and Henry had Kathy and I stand up and pretend we were the bride and the groom, and we went through the period of engagement and how the groom would go away and build, onto his father's house and then come back at a point in time unannounced, and then the wedding would happen, be finalized, and there would be a seven-day celebration, a time of tremendous joy. Well, that's what Jesus is talking about here. This is a time of tremendous joy. I'm with them. They shouldn't be fasting now. But he says, there will come a time when they will fast, when I will be taken away from them. And the term that he uses, taken, means to be suddenly and violently taken away. It's the first hint of the cross in Matthew's gospel. He's already beginning to allude to it in terms of the terminology that Jesus uses. Jesus at a point in time would be suddenly and violently taken away from his disciples in terms of his death. They would be fasting then. So again, that aspect then has no application for us as believers because Jesus rose again from the dead. And he tells us now, I'll never leave you and I'll never forsake you. So Jesus is with us. So in my new life, understanding Jesus has the authority to forgive sin. He wants to forgive sinners. If we realize we're sick and we need the doctor and we place our faith in him, he gives us a joy. And it's supposed to be a joy that's unending, just like the wedding feast. That's his first illustration. The second thing he says that's very important, he says that sinners with a new life should not turn to the traditions of men. And he goes on to this illustration of talking about fabric that's new. If it's sewn with fabric that's old, then when it's washed, it shrinks this one's going to begin shrinking and tearing away. And then he talks about wine that is new, that is not fermented. What do you call wine that's unfermented? That's the kind we drank at Passover. Grape juice. That's the kind Jesus made. Unfermented, because to ferment means it's decaying and rotting. It creates alcohol in the process, but that's the idea. And so he says new wine can be poured again into a new wineskin. But if it's poured into an older wineskin and it begins the fermenting process, then it will burst the skin. Something that's new cannot be added to something that's old. I want to tell you the traditional way of understanding this. I'll tell you what I believe is the proper way of understanding it. Traditionally, this is taught that Jesus is saying you can't take the new covenant or New Testament teaching and somehow add that to the old covenant or the Old Testament teaching. The two are incompatible. The two do not go together. One will tear away, you know, from the other one. But I want to suggest to you that that's nowhere in the text. That's just a traditional teaching. I want to tell you where it comes from. It comes from the church very early on, by about the second or third century, that was already becoming very anti-Semitic. And then it's carried on and exemplified early on in Roman Catholicism. But it goes back before then, and I could give you many examples of quotes by Justin Martyr, some of the other early church leaders that were very anti-Semitic already. And there was an attempt at that point to start calling, instead of saying the Bible, they would say Old Testament, New Testament, old, like we don't need it anymore, as opposed to new. But again, what book are we studying on Wednesday night? Old Testament, and we're just being blessed through the book of Psalms. Love to go through the Leviticus. Those great studies on infectious skin diseases, very popular. But you know what? It tells us what sin does in the grace of God. You know, the tabernacle is all about the person and the work of Christ. You know, we commune and learn more about Jesus through our study of the Bible, as opposed to the old and the new. So that's where that teaching comes from. So let's go back to our text. Who's asking the question and what is the question? It's the disciples of John the Baptist. And they're saying, why don't your disciples fast like we do and like the Pharisees do? Well, again, their fasting had nothing to do with the Old Testament. It had nothing to do with the Old Covenant. It had nothing to do with the law. It had nothing to do with the Bible. It had to do with the hedge that they had built around it. Their tradition, man's tradition, the traditions of man that Jesus would constantly come against over and over and over again was that you would fast twice a week. Now, did the Jews fast in the Old Testament? Once. One day a year on the Day of Atonement. But it wasn't a big deal. It wasn't a big deal. Sometimes people would fast. It's usually associated with mourning at the loss of a loved one and so forth. But they had developed around it this hedge, this tradition. Jesus is saying for the new believer that understands I have the authority to forgive sins because I'm God come in the flesh, that realizes that I have compassion for anyone and anyone that can be forgiven. And then when they are forgiven, it's supposed to be like a great celebration because I'll never leave you and I'll never forsake you. And the thing you need to guard against is not getting caught up in the traditions of men. because that's like putting new wine in an old wineskin, new cloth on old cloth. It just won't work. Don't become religious for the sake of religion alone. It's about a relationship with me. And if you buy into that tradition, you're going to begin to lose the joy that is meant to have as a person that's been forgiven of their sins and come into a relationship with Jesus Christ. Again, parable of the new wine and old wine is talking about something that is unfermented, that's pure, but it's going to begin to break down, and you're going to lose it if you go back to mere tradition. Jesus can forgive our sins, heal the sick. Let me just end with this kind of a final statement. As the physician, Jesus offers spiritual health. As the bridegroom, he brings new joy and love to our lives. He does not give us patchwork clothing, but rather robes of righteousness. He has the new wine of the Spirit to give, and this new life is not a famine, it's not a funeral, it's a feast. Let's pray. Lord, we do thank you for your grace and your mercy, and for Jesus Christ, the Messiah that came and showed us his compassion, that gave us his credentials, fulfilling prophecy, as Matthew points out time and time again, healing everyone that came to him, having seen now his power over nature, his power over the spiritual realm, and now, very importantly, his power to forgive sin, all sin. If we come to him and confess our sins, receive his grace, he forgives all of our sin, past, all of our sin, present, all our sin in the future that he knows we're going to commit even before we commit it. Lord, your grace is amazing grace. May we even have an image, Lord, of you sitting in this great banquet hall filled with not very spiritual people, filled with, again, the tax collectors and the most immoral people that were in that city and in that region gathered around you. Lord, that you might give them a message of forgiveness and repentance, that they can be saved from their sins, just as we are saved from our sins by your grace, and that we're to experience then, Lord, the doctor that completely heals, that we're with the bridegroom, you'll never leave us or forsake us, and that we get to experience the joy of walking with you. God, help us to not fall into a tradition, and the traditions that really make us religious, that can make us like Pharisees, that take our eyes off of you and the joy of what you've done on our behalf. And we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
In these desperate times, in these darkened days, though we try and try and try, we all will fall in some way. We are struggling toward the light, we are all running toward your voice, striving for the prize to come to your throne where you reign. And we are all hiding till we're fine. Though we try and try and try, we all will fall somewhere. We are all struggling toward the light. We are all running toward your light.
Shall not Do you feel so much better about your voices? How's everybody today?
Hope and love.